happy? Look at my Kate Lynn by my side. Fetch me the gin, son.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Tim TV, also known as Happy Hour with Maestro Tim. Listen, I have to thank you guys for following us over these past few weeks. Our audience has just exploded. Last week we had our cello soloist, Zul Bailey. I can't believe how many people were actually tuned in for that, and Michael Doherty the week before that. So thank you for sticking with us, and I know this time we also have a terrific program in store for you. I'm joined by local historian Mark Hunter Stoffer, and also Jen Ailes, who's the owner and operator of Moniker 86 Social Club. So before we even start, as we do normally with our cocktail, Jen, we're wearing masks right now, and you mentioned an initiative about mask awareness or mask wellness. Please tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, so down in Iowa City, there was a doctor that started a program called Mask of Wellness, just to make us more aware and to protect our patrons. And it was brought to Cedar Rapids by the Med Quarter, and we are part of that district. And so we've adopted that policy as well. And so that just means basically that we take caution, we wear gloves, we sanitize, we wear masks just to protect both our employees and our patrons of our restaurants.
Great, so where is your restaurant exactly?
Yeah, so it's down on 3rd Avenue. It is the old Daniel Arthur's building, just a couple of blocks away from IC Church.
So if only we had a historian to tell you more about that building. Mark, tell us a little bit more about where her business is and what it means.
It's one of the last surviving Mansion Hill District homes. The address has always been 821 3rd Avenue Southeast, and it dates to the mid-1880s. It was built in about 1885, and it was built for a family known as the Carpenters, not the Singers, by the well-known Cedar Rapids family. It actually was built for a widow, Maria Carpenter, and her children as a replacement home for an older house that the Carpenter family. The Carpenters were involved in major development in the area just east of the new Bow area right now. And they used to have a large house where Metro High School was now. And so they gave up that old piece of real estate so they could build the Tyler School there, which is now Metro. And then they decided to move the family to what was known as the Mansion Hill area of Cedar Rapids, which is roughly near the 800 blocks of 1st, 2nd, 3rd Avenues. And they built this beautiful brick veneer house for Maria and the children. And Maria was the widow of Gabriel Carpenter. So Carpenter's name is seen on almost anybody's real estate abstracts in the what's now the Oak Hill neighborhood and that section of Cedar Rapids over there. So the Carpenters lived there for most of the late 19th century. There was another family living there for a short time from 1915 to 1920, and by the early 1920s, it became the Beatty Funeral Home. A lot of us remember that being the Beatty Funeral Home up until the early 1980s when it became a restaurant known as Cafe de Close.
Cafe de Close, yeah. Yep. So it has a very distinguished history of wine and spirits. So what are you gonna poison with us today? Because over these past few months, I have been upping my game in terms of making cocktails, but I always believe, ladies and gentlemen, get a professional. If it's for taxes, if it's for legal help, it's for music, or it's for food and drink, get a professional. What do you have in store for us today?
So we're gonna make a cocoa old-fashioned. So an old-fashioned dates back into the Prohibition era age.
Yep.
So we're gonna kind of modernize it with a little cocoa syrup here. So I'm gonna go ahead and show you how to make
it. Sure,
this.
So cocoa syrup, I mean, do you make it yourself? Or?
We do make this ourselves. So what we have in it is some allspice berries, some black peppercorns, vanilla bean, demerara sugar, water. Pretty simple to make, but there's a lot of ingredients to go into it. In addition, do a little bit of fresh ginger.
Right. Yeah.
So for that little citrusy punch to it. So okay. You're ready to go ahead.
We're ready to go. Yeah. Templeton, nice local product or ish. Yeah.
So we use Templeton rye whiskey. Probably should have taken this off first. There we go. And we go 1.5 ounces of Templeton rye.
Yeah.
And then we're going to take this homemade cocoa syrup, flip our shaker upside down. We're only going to do 1/2 ounce of this. And then we're going to use a little bit of Escalato bitters.
So what is bitters?
So bitters is a great question. So there's a little bit of alcohol in it. It provides a whole different level of flavor to your drinks. So it's going to bring a little bit of bitterness to it and then add a little bit more complex flavor than just the drink would be without.
Okay, yeah.
So with that, we go about 1/4 drop on that. Get a little
Mmm, I can smell it from here.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. It's tasty stuff. One trick whenever you're making a drink, you want to make sure you put your ice in afterwards, because as you're pouring your alcohol in, you're just going to water it down with your ice. So, put ice in afterwards. Gotta do 50 stirs, don't do 49. 50.
Really 50.
And if you're talking to me while I talk, I'm gonna use two.
Yeah, I know many musicians like that. Because we can only count to four.
I'm secretly counting on my toes and my fingers right now.
So what's the magic number? Why the magic number? And by the way, I'm hoping you can stick around for another 15 minutes, even when we go on to talk with Mark. I'm going to be done my first drink in 15 minutes, so feel free to make another one.
We will definitely, we'll just line them up.
Oh, please, I need all the help I can.
All right, and you're going to go ahead and use a big cube, because that will keep it nice and cold, again, without watering it down.
Title Moniker 86?
That's an interesting question. So the term 86 in restaurants means you're out of something. And it actually originated back in the 1920s. There was a bar called Crumley's in New York, and he was in cahoots with the cops. So even though he was serving alcohol, the cops would call and say, hey, we're coming. They would raid the front door, and he would yell, 86. Well, everyone would run out the back alley door, which the address was 86 Bedford Street. So that's kind of how we started with our name. And then Moniker means alias, and so we just thought it was kind of a fun play on the words.
Perfect. Yeah.
So we're going to go ahead and pour this. Let's make sure it is even.
Oh. Squeeze it harder.
Fresh oranges when you're doing this, because otherwise you won't get the oil from the orange rind in there, which is an important part, because obviously you're going to taste this with both your nose and your mouth. And we're leaving this one without. These are some boozy cherries, which you actually booze up in-house. And again, they're going to be boozed with some black peppercorns and alcohol.
Well, cheers to you.
Cheers.
Moniker 86 Social Club, you've got to get one of these and so much more. So thank you so much for being our guest. And I guess that means Mark and I actually have to go to work. But in the meantime, we'll enjoy yours. Thank you very much. Okay, let's go up there.
Guys.
Thank you.
Thanks to Jen Ailes, and it smells divine, it tastes great, and I'm seeing everybody in the chat room looking at us with great envy. Diana Nolan, saving you from pulling weeds? Sure, but hey, you gotta have a cocktail.
That's great.
Oh, Kathy, yes, I miss seeing the Paramount as well. Yeah, it's nice to have this opportunity to actually do this in our home. Jeanette, what are you drinking? Are you back onto your whiskey sours, or have you graduated up to something here? Anyway, I'm so glad. I'm glad you're all here. Make sure you have time to pour yourself a cocktail. And in the meantime, Mark and I are going to chat. So, I have been here for almost 15 years.
Yep.
Okay, so I've only known the Paramount as the home of the symphony.
Right.
But in, 8 years, this grand building actually turns 100. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure Cedar Rapids was rather different 100 years ago.
Oh, it was very different. But in the same way, there were a lot of things that were similar in terms of culturally in the downtown area. We had a long history of great cultural attractions in the downtown Cedar Rapids area. We are known as the downtown area had was the location of the largest opera house in this part of the country. between 1880 and early 1920s.
Let me stop you there, yeah. Because a lot of people, you say opera. Opera? Well, yeah. that was an American thing?
Yeah.
In fact, they used to be everywhere, weren't they?
Oh, yeah, it was everywhere. It was just something that was kind of brought over with the immigrants that came over from Europe.
Right.
And if you look at the history of virtually any town, large or small, for instance, here in the state of Iowa.
There's one in Alcater.
They all had opera
houses.
That's
great, yeah.
They all had opera houses, opera halls. There were many right here in Linn County. And it was... you know, the tradition of going to see grand opera.
Right.
And of course, when the railroad system was really established, we had traveling shows, traveling opera troupes and so forth that would go across the country from the bigger cities. And it was just part of that, having a good-sized theater in your community was a great way to build up your community and build up additional commerce, additional quality of life. And so Cedar Rapids had really kind of started that trend with a couple of opera houses, a Union Opera House in 1870, and a very large Green's Opera House in 1880, which was named after Judge George Green. The Green Square is named after one of the key figures in Cedar Rapids history. And it was such a magnificent facility that it was the only game in town for 20 years.
Sure.
The only place to go. And it was located up on 2nd Street Northeast. There's kind of a Wells Fargo, former Brenton Bank building right there right now across from Roosevelt. And it didn't... Some opera houses in some communities, especially here in Iowa, some of them were modified and converted into other types of entertainment, stage shows and movies. Ours was not. And it kind of maintained its status as an opera house only, even going in towards the year 1910. At that time, we had many movie theaters that were being built up in Cedar Rapids at that time. We actually had a very large vaudeville theater called the Majestic. So the Majestic and the Greens were kind of the precursors to places like the Paramount here. And they kind of set the stage. Greens Opera House and the Majestic Theater were the two that really made a statement that the culture had really arrived in Cedar Rapids. And we had the facilities that could host every form of entertainment that went to Chicago, New York, California, from Europe, because we were on the rail lines that those entertainers went on.
You know, it
all came here.
It's interesting. Even today, yeah. Fast forward all these years yeah. later, being in Cedar Rapids, we are equidistant from Chicago,
yes.
from Minneapolis, from St. Louis, Kansas City. And so even to this day, when acts come through the Paramount,
yeah.
They're usually on tour, and that's how we get them, because they're already on their way to these cities.
Right. So in the early days, you had big stage stars like Sarah Bernhardt and, you know, the Barrymores and John Philip Sousa. And the great actors of the stage before films came along would play Cedar Rapids on a Tuesday or Wednesday night
right.
on their way from Chicago to Omaha or from St. Paul to St. Louis.
So what happened to these initial opera houses? Were they torn down or did they burn down? Because a lot of them kind of weren't very friendly to fire.
Yeah, one did burn. A lot of people, the earlier one, the Greens Opera House, that one did not burn. That was actually converted several years before this theater opened up. The Greens Opera House could not compete anymore with the many small, medium-sized theaters that had popped up. Downtown Cedar Rapids had as many as 10 separate theaters at one time. 10.
10.
And there were 3 in what's now the New Bohemia neighborhood, and there were 3 in what's now the Kingston Village neighborhood.
Wow.
It's a lot of theaters. And so they were kind of seen as an outdated facility, and it got converted into an indoor parking garage. An opera house got turned into an indoor parking garage. And
the singing must have been terrible.
It must have been terrible. So they put a false ceiling in the Greens Opera House at 113 2nd Street Northeast, and people parked their cars in what used to be the main floor of the state of the Opera House, and then above the false ceiling, they had 3 balconies in the Opera House, and all that area was hidden above the false ceiling. And nobody saw that for 45 years.
Wow.
And that Opera House building stood until the late 1960s. It was still right across 2nd Street from the Roosevelt Hotel, the Roosevelt building up there, and was part of the urban renewal projects of downtown Cedar Rapids. It was just something that people had forgotten. It was an opera house. And I've talked to many people who got a chance to sneak up into that area, and some remnants of the old balconies were still there even in the 1960s. The Majestic Theater, which used to be at the corner of A Avenue and 3rd Street, so this would be now part of the expanded convention center. Of the U.S. Cellular Center on the A Avenue side. It did burn in a fire. It had 2 balconies, and it was built by theater architects Rapp and Rapp. They built many theaters across the United States that were called Majestic. In fact, this was their second one after they built the one in Chicago, which has recently hosted the Hamilton show. So that one was built in Chicago, then they built one here in Cedar Rapids.
Wow.
And it was still open when the Paramount opened up at the Capitol Theater in 1920, so it's actually competition.
Okay, so let me stop you there, because so once upon a time, Cedar Rapids had more theaters they can shake a stick at.
It did.
So why did we need a bigger Paramount? Why this? Because this is, now we jump ahead to 1927, 28?
27, there's an announcement of two, not just one, not just this one, but two. I'm sorry, two, not four. Two, the drink's not affecting me, it's not. Two, because the existing theaters, the existing 10 theaters that were in the downtown area, could not handle the capacity of the crowds. There was that much demand for theater entertainment. And we didn't have enough theaters to fill all the shows, to show all the films. There were three movie houses operating on First Avenue, or three on Second Avenue. There was a fairly good size theater already operating on Third Avenue. The Strand Theater, which in later years we remember as the World Playhouse, down by the train tracks there. But there was, and it was kind of a status symbol. Most cities in America, in the great economic financial boom of the mid to late 1920s, they were calling them movie palaces. It wasn't just a movie theater. It was theater experience.
Well, let's come full circle. I mean, a lot of films, movie complexes now are trying to double down on the food and the luxury items. Hey, Brian Glick wants to ask you a question. Was the Majestic where the hotel is?
No, it was not where the hotel is. That's a very good question. Until the year 2011, after the flood of 2008, we tore down some sections of the U.S. Cellular Center. And we also tore down some structures that had been built by the Armstrong Company. Many people might remember on A Avenue and 3rd Street, there was a building called Professional Park on A Avenue and 3rd Street. That's where the Majestic Theater was. The auditorium for the Majestic Theater stood where, for many years, was Armstrong's parking garage. It was an Armstrong ramp on A Avenue right by the interstate. And it said Armstrong parking on it. And in fact, when that building was torn down in 2011, if you went in the alley's not there anymore, they'd taken the alley out with the new expanded convention center, you could still see part of the old brick wall. After the fire, the Majestic Theater Auditorium was completely gutted out after the 1934 fire, and they used the exterior brick walls to form the basis of future parking facilities. So it's not unusual. We hear this in a country where old theaters are converted into parking facilities, and in Cedar Rapids' case, there was even an instance where a parking facility was turned into a theater.
Really?
It happened on First Avenue. That's another story. That's a place called the Times Theater.
Yeah. Jen Hartman, that kind of tongue-in-cheek, is, you know, were their acoustics better when they turned it into a parking lot or worse?
I know, exactly. Yeah, exactly. So the Majestic is really kind of forgotten now, but it really was a spectacular theater. And longtime attorney Tom Riley, before he passed away, he told me many, many years ago that he was in New York City and near Broadway. He ran into comedian Milton Berle.
Mm-hmm.
And Milton Berle got into a conversation with Mr. Riley and said to him, "So where are you from?" And he said, "I'm from Cedar Rapids, Iowa." He says, "I remember playing on the stage at the Majestic in Cedar Rapids."
Well, you know, Milton Berle, so he grew up in the age of vaudeville.
Yes.
Okay, so these theaters begin as, well, from opera house to vaudeville to movie house.
Right.
So there is a reason why all these buildings have a little bit of a stage to them, not just for screens. So.
Yes, yeah. Even the small neighborhood theaters. There's a couple that still survive. In the New Bow neighborhood of Cedar Rapids, there's Ideal Theater. It's on 16th Avenue Southeast. Even a little theater that only had 400 seats in the South End neighborhood would still build at least an 8-foot stage. Just in case, because you never went to the theater, especially before World War II. You didn't just go to the theater to see a movie.
Right.
You would get a movie. You would get the news. You would get cartoons. You would get a magician act. You might get a dance act. You might get a funny animal act. You might get diving girls or something like that. You know, you're expected to get a lot for your 10 cents or your 25 cents.
Right.
And so people made a lot of people made their living by coming up with an original act. I mean, basically, it's America's Got Talent and American Idol of the 1890s through the 1930s, where literally you could just sell an act to a theater manager, and they would put you on a circuit of theaters throughout the Midwest. And so there's always something different to entertain you. And you could stay at the theater all day. That's what was great about it. Even when I was growing up in Cedar Rapids in the 1970s, that tradition was still going on. If you bought a movie theater ticket, like here at the Paramount, I could come down and see a movie, and I paid once, and it was not a real new first-run movie, they would let you stay in the theater all day, and I could watch the movie two or three times. There are many times my parents would drop me off at the Paramount here when I was a kid and say, see the movie twice, I'll pick you up in 4 hours, you know.
Fabulous.
It's great, yeah, it's great. So the entertainment quota was very, very high.
Right.
And so it really peaked in the 1920s when plans were made for this building. And this building was initially announced to be called the Capitol Theater and was announced to be constructed on this corner of 3rd Avenue and 2nd Street, southeast. At about the same time, a rival theater was planned at the corner of 1st Avenue and 3rd Street, the building we know as Theater Cedar Rapids. So we had these two theaters that were each going to average between 1,500 and 2,000 seats opening up in Cedar Rapids just to meet the demand of the theater going audience. What we tend to forget is that people used to go to the theater 3 to 4 times a week because the shows would change over that often. You might have the same show for 3 days and then the movies would change out and you had different entertainment acts. And remember, until television, the theater was the only place to get your news,
so
outside the newspapers.
Was this originally owned by a theater, a film studio? Is this because it seems to me the antitrust laws of breaking up the monopolies is kind of what changed the landscape of theaters in North America. So was this actually belonging to one of the great studios?
Not initially. If we look at one of the pictures we have, we put up one of the first pictures I have. We have a picture of the opening day of this building. September 1st, 1928. And what's really interesting about this particular theater is that it had the name Capitol when it was first built. The architects out of the East Coast, the theater company that built this named a lot of their buildings Capitol. Capitol is kind of an unusual name for theater for Cedar Rapids because we're not the capital of anything here.
Right.
By the time this building was only about 7 months old, it had a name change to Paramount. But, and that was involved with Paramount Pictures. What was happening with the studio system in the late 1920s is that the studios in California were buying up theaters and, or at least buying up the leases to the theater buildings. And the idea was that, so there was this chain called Paramount Public Theaters, PUBLIX, and they actually bought up two of the theaters in Cedar Rapids, the Capitol and the Strand Theater at 314 3rd Avenue down the street, which was later known as the World. And both of those theaters had name changes in the same year in 1929. The Strand's name was changed to State, and the Capitol was changed to Paramount because this theater was going to start showing exclusively
Paramount
Pictures.
Yep.
And so all across the country, you have Fox Theaters. St. Louis has one of the bigger Fox Theaters in the country. Warner Theaters. You had United Artists Theaters. There was a big one in Chicago, the United Artists Theaters. So the idea being that you would be very clear on which studios, because studios were very competitive. You know, stars had to sign contracts, you know, with certain studios. You know, you're only going to see a Humphrey Bogart movie in a Warner Brothers film, and you had to go to a Warner Brothers related theater to see Humphrey Bogart.
Right.
You know, so it was very much a lot of competition, studio system, and that's why this theater got the name Paramount. But if you look at this, I don't know if the picture's still up or not, but if you look at that original picture, look at the signage that's out there. They got these gigantic vertical signs that say Capitol. They got this big marquee that says Capitol. And so when the building was only 7 months old in the spring of 1929, they had to take down all these signs and put up gigantic new signs that said Paramount.
That's a pretty expensive retrofit.
It gives you an idea of the financial power that the studios had. No, this is when sound films were coming.
Right, and it's also I think the moral of the story, ladies and gentlemen, is the economic impact that the arts bring to a city.
Yes.
So many times people poo-poo the arts. That's just whatever. And when really, and it was much more obvious in the 1920s how entertainment and theater and music was actually the center of your economy.
Right. It was a key factor in Cedar Rapids' economic development. And this was a characteristic of, in the minds of the earliest Cedar Rapids community builders, the Green family, the Beavers, the Higleys. They all knew it wasn't enough to encourage big companies to come here, like Quaker Oats and the Sinclair Meatpacking Plant. Equally important to them was getting, in addition to commerce and industry, getting educational facilities here. This is why Coe College was a major focus for Cedar Rapids early on, and getting a high school established as soon as possible. But entertainment and the arts were incredibly important from day one. And so that's why we had the opera house as early as we did. Knowing that Cedar Rapids had a 2,000 seat opera house in 1880, only 40 years from when there were only five people living here.
Yeah, it's amazing.
You know, so we had a population of 10,000 people. We had an opera house that seated 2,000 people.
That's stunning.
That gives you an idea of the emphasis. So it was the arts emphasis for Cedar Rapids history that actually encouraged more companies to come and locate here, because it knew that there, the more population that would come here to work and live in Cedar Rapids, knew they had the arts to look forward to as part of their quality of life
right.
in Cedar Rapids.
So where do we go to from here, into the 30s and the 40s?
Yeah. Well, first of all, the second picture I have is kind of a early interior picture of the Capitol Theater. This is from a 1928 Chamber of Commerce book. And it's showing, you can see parts of the orchestra right there in the lower part of the picture. And so every theater, of course, had its own orchestra. You can see the big highlight of this particular building, of course, was the Wurlitzer organ. Pretty much every theater it had, even if it didn't have a full orchestra, it might have a six-piece orchestra, or it might have at least an organ, or at least a player piano or something, especially during the silent film era. And when the Capitol Theater opened here in September 1928, the opening movie was a silent film starring Richard Dix, Warming Up. But the combination of a music concert and other types of entertainment. This was not initially as big of a stage theater as the Iowa Theater, which later became Theater Cedar Rapids, but that was kind of billed as kind of a successor and competitor to the Majestic Vaudeville Theater. So they did more stage shows over there. This became known as the really first-class, first-run film theater. But it embraced the sound films right away within its first year with its name change. And the best thing that this theater had that no other place in Cedar Rapids had was air conditioning.
Ah, Old Joe.
Old Joe.
Tell us about Old Joe, because I know Old Joe quite well. He's still around.
Right. He's still kind of living in the basement of the building here. And the air conditioning system, known affectionately as Old Joe. Theaters had a big problem, especially when they got bigger in the United States. Of course, this was a problem for for centuries in Europe. You can't really run a theater in the summer because
it's too hot.
Yeah. It's too hot. So theaters would only have a season, which is why theater seasons tended to be from September through March or April, because you're going to shut down that building. So before this building was built, Cedar Rapids had kind of makeshift cooling systems in their older theaters, where they would come up with systems like getting blocks of ice from Hubbard Ice and putting them in the basement at the bottom of large air shafts, and then they would blow big fans on the ice and cool the theater that way. But by golly, the Capitol / Paramount had a bona fide first air conditioning system in Cedar Rapids. And so finally there was a relief, and that was really first appreciated in the summer of 1929, right before the stock market crash. And so this quickly became, we think that's why people were encouraged.
Do you want another drink?
Oh yeah, almost under your spot. The concept of staying in the building all day really right. came out of the air conditioning.
So I got here before the floods, 2006, so this building was still being cooled by Old Joe.
By Old Joe.
And I remember the stories of, during dramatic pauses in the music, you'd hear click, click.
Yeah.
Clunk, you could still hear the mechanics of Old Joe clanking away. You know, so it was kind of a hard nostalgic decision when we revitalized the theater that no, we're not going to be using Old Joe anymore.
Oh, yeah. Old Joe became a personal friend of everyone.
Yeah,
who came to the theater, who used the theater. It was built as one of the first air conditioning systems west of the Mississippi River. And the thumping of Old Joe, I think, was pretty agreeable compared to, you got to remember, every other theater in Cedar Rapids, at the time this building opened, was within one block of the railroad tracks.
So
you didn't have the sound of the trains coming by this theater. So Old Joe was a nice compromise.
That's an okay compromise.
It's okay to do that, so it was quite all right. And one thing I also want to mention about this location here was Before this theater was built here at 3rd Avenue, 2nd Street, this was the least attractive looking corner in downtown Cedar Rapids.
Why so?
After about 1900, about half of downtown Cedar Rapids still had these old rickety wood construction, Wild West looking buildings on some of its avenues still. And Cedar Rapids, as a way to kind of impress visitors and residents, there was a real push in the battle to be the better city in the Midwest, to replace your wood frame buildings with superstructures, you know, poured concrete buildings,
right,
brick and stone buildings. And one by one, every corner of downtown Cedar Rapids on 1st Avenue, 2nd Avenue, 3rd Avenue, which are the main downtown, you know, hub areas, got their old, outdated looking, not progressive looking buildings replaced. But this corner still had five rickety looking little buildings that looked like they were about to fall over. And the city leaders were almost in a panic about, oh my gosh, we've got the spanking new Higley building across the street, we got the new Killian department store across the other, on the other corner, we got the Granby building. What are we gonna do about this corner? And it really became imperative after the year 1912, because that's when a brand new 3rd Avenue bridge went in, replacing an older bridge. And so 3rd Avenue became very quickly a major avenue. It was also the fact that 3rd Avenue was between the new concrete bridge and the train station that was over by Green Square. And so there was a lot of pressure to build something. So we think that's why this location was chosen, because the Chamber of Commerce was really pushing for this corner to be improved. And it was the last of the major corners on 1st, 2nd, and 3rd Avenue between the river and the train tracks that really had to be improved in downtown Cedar Rapids.
Getting back to old Joe, Randy Reynolds, Concert Corral, thank you. I got another. Cheers. Cheers to you. And cheers to Jen. Thank you.
Yeah.
Things in Concert Corral used to warm up next to old Joe all the time.
Oh, yeah.
This bears repeating. So Jan Hartman says, did old Joel really run from 1928 to 2008? Really? Yeah. See, that's engineering.
Yeah.
It was built to last.
Yeah, because there was some discussion about what to do with it. You know, we had I don't want to jump ahead because there was an earlier renovation project that was very extensive, in 2003 and 2004. But, it was the hallmark of this building. And all the other theaters have done, that's what put this theater in the number one position in downtown Cedar Rapids. It was bigger, it was larger, it had the air conditioning.
Right.
And so, because of that, you paid a little more money to see a movie at the Paramount, once we got into the 1930s.
Let's jump ahead a little bit, because we've got about 15 minutes left.
Right.
Let's get into the 50s and 60s.
Here. Well, we can jump in. I want to make sure we kind of quickly show the pictures in order here.
Sure,
real quick.
Okay.
Only for a second, let's briefly look at the third picture, which is the, you can see the Capitol sign still in the front there. Do you notice that the marquee from 1928 looks like the marquee we have out there right now?
Yes.
Yeah. So this is marquee number one. What we have out there is kind of a modified marquee number three, which is really designed to really resemble the original marquee.
So that was actually consciously thought of when they were trying to...
Yes. And it was a very proud achievement of the Nesper Sign Company here in Cedar Rapids. In fact, the Nesper Sign Company, which is one of our great friends we see on the interstate every day going up and down in Cedar Rapids, this is really one of their great crowning achievements that they are proud of, the marquee that's out there. But going quickly to the next picture, we get into the 1930s very quickly, where we had this really interesting picture of from the 1930s at the Paramount movie theater. And you can see there's one of those great Andy Harvey movies that's playing. Marquee Love Finds Andy Harvey, so Judy Garland, Mickey Rooney, movie playing there. This is an unusual picture. You're probably distracted by what's going on in the street. There's actually a early semi-truck trying to back into the grocery store that was next door where the Opus Theater is now. Of course, the Fossil Building was a grocery store run by the Becker family in Cedar Rapids for a long time. But notice how we get a very large vertical Paramount sign. Jumping ahead to the next picture, we can get into that period that you just mentioned, the 1950s.
Actually, you know what? I did get ahead of myself because I see that Darren Ferriter is on. Online here.
And yes, Darren.
And he's heavily involved with Kratos, the Cedar Rapids Oregon Theater Society. So tell us a little bit about, we got to say a little something about the Wurlitzer, because we're talking about a time where movies are just going from silent film to talkies.
Right.
And music is a central role in that, and as is the Wurlitzer Oregon.
Yeah. One of my favorite, I know Darren will agree with me on this too, one of the great people connected with the Wurlitzer Oregon was a man named, a lot of us still remember and very fondly, is George Baldwin. And George Baldwin played on the Wurlitzer here at the Paramount for decades and decades. In fact, that first picture we showed you, the opening day of this building, September 1st, 1928, as a child, he was in that line. He was here on the opening day, and he was still playing on a Wurlitzer in the, between 2000 and 2010. So the Wurlitzer was really kind of a signature feature. Darren probably knows more about the Wurlitzer than anyone I know. But the experience, you know, one thing I will constantly fall back on in this, in any discussion about the history of the Paramount, is the life experience of going to the Paramount is, I think, always personified and amplified, no pun intended, by the experience of stealing that beautiful Wurlitzer organ, rising out of the floor prior to every movie experience, every stage performance that happened and so forth. It was just something that was really something that you look forward to, and you knew you were in a special place.
Yeah.
Knew you were in a special place. And most of the larger theaters in downtown Cedar Rapids did have built-in organs. Darren knows more about the specifics of that particular history.
Yeah. Even the current Theater Cedar Rapids yes. building had one.
The Barton organ. And because the Barton has still functioning in the Iowa Theater, the Theater Cedar Rapids, and of course we lost the original Wurlitzer here.
Spectacularly, I must say. Yeah.
Spectacular. Luckily, another one was found that was made, I think, either right after the one that was made.
So I got to tell you,
New Jersey or North Carolina?
Yeah, this is what I find so amazing about these organ guys. They're a lot like classic car fanatics. I mean, they will not only find the authentic part, but they will get the part as close as they could find to the assembly line that was nearest their own that we lost. So the work that they did on the Wurlitzer was just spectacular detective work, as well as just renovation.
So really, we really have a Wurlitzer still here of the same era, which is not obviously the same as having the original anymore, but it's really the next best thing.
Right.
And because both the Paramount and Theater Cedar Rapids still have theater organs, we're one of the only, one of the very few communities in the entire United States that can say there are two theater organs operating in two downtown movie palaces. Yeah. You know, we're very rare, even in the state of Iowa, to have two theaters of this caliber still standing, in many cases, other than things like a flood or a pandemic. Both theaters have continuously been operating Cedar Rapids for 92 years for the most part.
So let's get to the 50s, because what you just said sort of reminded me what happened in the 70s when a lot of these great buildings start to molder. Yeah. But really the heyday was the 50s, 60s in many ways.
Well, it was the heyday for all large theaters like this, especially as movie theaters, because movies got grander and bigger in the 1950s because of television. Because if you didn't readapt the movies by adding more color films and adding widescreen, you know, with things like VistaVision and widescreen movies, you know, that was a way to keep people coming back to the theaters in the 1950s. And going into the 1960s, the new threat for big places like this was the expansion of the suburban areas of cities. And Cedar Rapids saw that coming. There were plans for developing the Lindell Plaza area, which we now know as Lindell Mall. But downtown Cedar Rapids had built such a vibrant downtown retail center between 1880 and 1960. In the mid-1950s, downtown Cedar Rapids had over 210 retail stores. That's more than Coleridge and Lindell combined.
Right.
Over the years, we had anywhere between 6 and 10 movie theaters. We had 18 hotels down here at one time. And it was such a juggernaut, and everyone loved downtown Cedar Rapids. And the people in particular who ran the local department stores, like Armstrong's and Killian's, felt very threatened by what might happen in the suburbs. And they actually did something in Cedar Rapids that was not done in other cities the size of Cedar Rapids. They actually, Armstrong's department store in particular, actually built in 1959 a brand new downtown department store. Nobody was doing it anywhere else in the country. And the idea was to get that open a year before Lindell Shopping Center. And because that was such a successful strategy move that the downtown stayed solvent as a retail entertainment hub, especially movie theaters, for another 20 years. So movie theaters like the Paramount, now in other cities like Des Moines, Waterloo, Davenport, many of them even had Paramount theaters, they went on a downward spiral. And they went to being like second-run theaters. They got derelict, they were closed, they were abandoned. Des Moines' beautiful Paramount Theatre was actually imploded, was exploded in 1979.
Purposely.
They purposely blew up the Paramount, and with the vertical sign and everything, it was really, they should have kept it for us, you know?
Right.
But anyway, so actually, by the time we got to 1960, downtown Cedar Rapids was down to three theaters, the three largest, the Paramount, the Iowa, and the theater on 3rd Avenue that had been the State Theater for a number of years. Because of the new department store, other department stores decided to stay downtown. And national stores like JCPenney and Montgomery Ward's also stayed downtown. And that meant that everybody was still coming downtown, and the three big theaters decided to actually invest more money into the theaters. And so the Paramount got big widescreen, 70-millimeter screen. The Iowa Theater had a major renovation done in 1965 with wider seating, a bigger screen. And the old State Theater on 3rd Avenue had over $1 million refit. And it was given a brand new name of the World Playhouse. It opened up in November of 1960, right down the street with the movie Ben-Hur.
Right.
And opened up the same week that John F. Kennedy was. So the 60s saw a resurgence of downtown movie theaters. So the Paramount could not be used for stage shows during the 60s and 70s, even though there was a growing need for it. It was needed as a movie theater still in the 1960s and 70s.
So a couple things you need to know. One of your biggest fans, and I affectionately call him an orchestra stalker, Dennis Green.
Dennis. I love Dennis.
Who,
good to hear from Dennis. Hi, Dennis.
Operates KCCK, one of our great friends. As a matter of fact, was one of my first guests on this show.
Yeah.
He based a character in one of his books on you, by the way.
He did.
Yeah, he did. I'm sure he was sexy and hunky and really smart, and you're not going to sue him, are you?
Coming from Dennis Green, I'm really honored.
Okay,
really
so honored. You also need to hear this from Linda Hamrick.
And I knew that too.
So she said, my first visit to the Paramount was probably back in the 80s.
Yep.
When we first moved here from Tennessee, I had a seat in the balcony.
Yep.
This kind of previews what's about to happen.
Yeah.
Not just to the Paramount, but to buildings like this throughout the country. Because the 70s and the 80s weren't kind to buildings like this.
No.
So she was here in the 80s. I had a seat in the balcony. I sat down and felt a lump. When I got up to see what it was, I discovered there was a dead bat in my seat.
Yeah. So going to a movie, the Paramount Theater was a nice movie theater all through the 1960s. And as we got into the early 1970s, the city leaders realized there was a push to build a West Side suburban shopping area, which would become Westdale. And so the writing was kind of on the wall that ultimately these old theaters are going to have to cease to function as movie theaters. And so, plus the addition of the first multiplex theaters popped up in Cedar Rapids. So there was a Stage 4 theater opened up in 1971 in the Easttown Cinema on the east side.
Yeah, Kathy Varney just mentioned that early on. That's where she went to the movies all the time.
Yep, Stage 4. Yeah, well, Rob Barrett, who I'm sure you know, worked at Stage 4 back in the 90s. And so they started putting less money into the theaters like the Paramount. But that's the era I saw movies here. I saw movies here as a kid in the last 5 to 6 years that this was a movie house. And it was not the experience at the Paramount that you have today.
Right.
It smelled like really old popcorn. There was gum and food. They didn't always clean the theater up on a regular basis. It was very dark. Most of the lights didn't work. And the last full year that this was an active movie theater was the year 1975. And by then you were getting movies playing here like The House on Cemetery Hill.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes you get a good movie like I saw The Return of the
Living. We're talking the B-.
Which is something that you might see at the drive-in theater in Cedar Rapids. So they still would show the occasional first-run films. You know, there were still some big films that played here, but it became very quickly apparent that downtown Cedar Rapids could very soon not support three big theaters.
Right.
And at the same time this realization was happening, the city was pushing for the development of a large civic center, what we now know as the U.S. Cellular Center. And this has been going on for years. Prior to the U.S. Cellular Center, our big venue in Cedar Rapids was the Veterans Memorial Coliseum on Mays Island, which was very outdated and too small. And so as a result of the urban renewal projects, in fact, one third of downtown Cedar Rapids was destroyed because of urban renewal projects between 1957 and 1973. Now, mostly happened.
This includes the destruction of the train station, right?
Well, the train station was an early urban renewal project that was actually tied into the development, strangely enough, the development of the Lindale area. Lindale Plaza Shopping Center opened up in 1960. Our train station went down the following summer in 61 because the downtown had just rejuvenated itself with a new department store and new investment in the movie theaters, but downtown Cedar Rapids in 1961 had no city parking ramps. There was only one parking ramp in the downtown area, and the train station site was seen as too valuable for parking.
Yeah.
And so at the time, it seemed like a good decision.
Good idea at the time.
More parking for shoppers to keep them from going to Lindo. So, but parking was a big issue for causing a lot of destruction. So a big area of First Avenue was torn down for the idea of creating a 10,000-seat arena. But this just languished for 10, 12 years.
Right.
And the original plan on First Avenue from 3rd Street to 5th Street by the old YMCA was to build a brand new 10,000-seat civic arena, a hotel, a convention center, and a brand new performing arts theater. And a performing arts theater would have been between the train tracks and 5th Street.
Right.
And then they realized they needed a parking ramp instead. And then that's when the mayor of the time, Don Canning, got his head together with local resident Peter Bazanson. Peter Bazanson had just, this was about 1974.
Right.
Peter Bazanson was very involved in downtown redevelopment in the 1960s and 1970s. And he and Robert Armstrong had recently built the Cedar River Tower Apartments in 1974. And they came to the rescue of what to do about the performing arts theater dilemma. And they realized that the future of the Paramount was gloomy at best as a movie house. And they said, rather than let it close and become a derelict theater for years to come, like it was already happening in places like Waterloo and Des Moines and Davenport, because having an abandoned movie palace is not a good thing for
your bad for business. Yeah.
Bad for business. And they came up with the idea, what if we do a win-win? And this is going into 1976, so there was a big push for historic preservation with the country's bicentennial. And Peter Bazanson came up with the idea of saying, what if I bought the Paramount Theater? And then I, in turn, gave it to the city for $1. And that's how the Paramount became a city performing arts theater, just like that.
And this is the beginning of really the history, modern history of Orchestra Iowa, then the Cedar Rapids Symphony.
Because the symphony needed a home.
We needed a home, because we used to play at Co. all the time.
Right.
So tell us a little bit more about that, because in many ways I see Peter Bazanson as the father of our orchestra, in terms of our modern era.
Yeah, Peter and Lorraine Bazanson. And I knew Peter pretty well. We used to live at the Cedar River Tower together at one time, different floors. And the symphony was so in need of a venue like this. And they almost probably thought that maybe they might get something like the Paramount when the shopping centers were starting to go up. But then they just couldn't get their hands on a place like this because they were still needed for movie theaters.
Sure.
And so the idea was that the symphony would move into the brand new performing arts theater on First Avenue. Once that was scrapped, everything just kind of came together really nice. They thought, why not have the Cedar Rapids Symphony be the permanent attraction, the permanent tenant of the Paramount Theater of the Performing Arts?
Right.
And I'm telling you, Tim, it was just great how this happened here because and you see this, I don't know if you put up the picture from the 50s of one of the last pictures of it being a movie theater in the late 1950s. And then the next picture, which was actually taken by me.
This is the one with the more sepia in color?
Yes, kind of sepia in color. I took this picture in 1983, just a few years, 6 years after this became a performing arts theater. And that's the original trapezoid marquee that's the second marquee in the theater building. And you can see it still looks like a movie theater.
Yeah.
But they literally, overnight, like one day it was a movie theater, and the very next day it was the Paramount Theater of Performing Arts.
That's amazing.
It never closed.
Yeah.
It never closed. So literally, January 6, 1976, was the last time a regular movie played here. It was a Telly Savalas action film
Who loves you, baby?
Killer Force. Killer Force. Telly Spouse was the last big head that you saw on the screen on January 6th. And the very next, in fact, that night, the city had a press conference and banquet celebrating the acquisition and the creation of the Paramount Theatre for the Performing Arts. And the very next day, we started doing Say Show. So that's why renovations had to happen piecemeal from time to time over the next several decades, because, and that is almost unheard of in American theater history like this, because usually what happens in a city like Cedar Rapids is that you have this great movie palace down here in a downtown area. It shuts down for years and years and years. I keep thinking about buildings like the Oriental in Chicago.
Right, right.
And then it's at the point where you think it's going to be torn down.
Right.
But that didn't happen here.
Many of them do turn into parking lots. I mean, we are so lucky to have this. Yeah. Mark, I'm going to have to have you come back, and we've got to talk about the modern era of the Paramount, because now you're talking my language when the orchestra becomes its major tenant.
Yeah, there's so much more to talk
about. A lot happens from 1976 when I was a lot younger. And and to today. I mean, it's not just like they lived happily ever after. There was a lot of ups and downs, and there's a lot more history to come. So will you come back?
I will absolutely come back, and I'm honored to do so.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, I am so delighted that you tuned in for this. Stay tuned. I'm going to have him back probably within a month or so, whenever we can agree on this. I just thought this would be great to have an opportunity to talk about our home that we tend to take for granted. When I first got here, people loved the Paramount, but we didn't realize how much we cherished this building until it was almost gone during the flood. And now we're in a time during the pandemic where this building is silent yet again, and we're feeling its absence. So I want to thank you for being here, because we need to talk about this more. So I want to thank Jen Ailes for her incredible chemistry, alchemy, making a great old-fashioned. And if she's still around, I'm going to ask her to make me yet another one. And I want to thank you for being here. And next week we'll be talking to Bill Jones, and who's the director of Orchestral Studies at the University of Iowa, and Ann Carter, who's also a board member. And we're going to talk about something pretty serious. We're going to be talking about race relationships and diversity difficulties we have in our industry in the wake of Black Lives Matter. So tune in for that. And until then, we'll see you then. And Mark, thank you so much. Cheers.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you.